to officially welcome you on behalf of the College of Arts and Sciences at the University of the South. I'm so glad you could all come and join us for this conference. I'm not sure I've ever been at a conference that it was so geographically fixed as this one. And I wanted, as a kind of an opening, I wanted to make comments about two things. And first, that I think that the idea of a body conference is it's a fascinating subject, the body. And it's partially a fascinating subject because it's an important subject. I am right now reading the book that we're going to use for the incoming first-year students next summer, and that's Ta-Nehisi Coates' book, Between the World and Me. And I think that will lead to all kinds of interesting conversations. I've already heard that a number of the Posse students, for example, are not crazy about this choice. And that's because many of them come from Prince George County, and he spends a lot of time talking about the difficulties of Prince George County. Am I right about that? And so I think one of the assumptions will be that, you know, the white students aren't going to like the book and the black students are going to like the book, and that's clearly already not the case. So it will make, I think, interesting conversations. And in that book, and the reason I bring it up is in that book, how many people have read this book? Some people read this book? Yeah. It's a fascinating book. And one of the things that he does is he talks about sort of the metaphor and the reality of the body and the threat to the African-American body, and how it's stolen, how it's maimed, how it's constrained. And he's asking us to think about what is at risk for the body and for a whole group of people as a result of that. And that just had me thinking about this idea, the metaphor and the reality of the body. And we know now, too, that there's also a great debate, once again, about women's bodies and women's right to choose and who has control over women's bodies. And so the issue of the body is at the center, I think, of a number of things we're talking about as a community, as a population right now. And even in our current political process, we have, I think, devolved to the point where we're not talking about important things like a woman's right to choose or African American bodies. What we're really talking about is the bodily appearances of two Republicans' wives, or the relative value and size of body parts. This is the point to which we've devolved. And I think we can do better. And so I think this conference then comes at an important time when we're not understanding very well what really the important issues are about the body. So I ask you to talk about that. And then I ask you to write about that through your various disciplines and through your various interdisciplines. And not to forget to enter the public debate as well. I think we have an obligation to be public intellectuals. I think we have an obligation to add our wisdom to those conversations. I think we have an obligation to quote famous people to raise the level of debate in this country. And some of you will know the source of that. Now, second, while that topic is important in general, I want to assert that it's also an important moment for us because of this conference here, that it's a conference and specifically that it's here. Our own people make up the bulk of this conference, a bulk of the papers. And so many of us, young faculty and more veteran faculty, many of our faculty don't know each other's work very well. And so many of us, young faculty and veteran faculty, we don't know each other all that well. And so I do hope that having a conference here in these days that is an intense and local conference where many of us are in a position to be around each other a lot more, I hope that this will be a time of melding our faculty into one body, if I could push that metaphor perhaps a little bit, of starting new conversations among your colleagues, of starting new potential collaborations, of continuing and developing other current ones. And I think this can be really very important for the college. I think it's especially important for what I've been talking about, creating a 21st century college. For us to become known for our intellectual engagement, both here on this mountain and in the wider academic communities of our disciplines. So I ask you to present great papers. I ask you to hear great papers. I ask you to have great conversations, and I ask you please to hear each other. And some of these conversations may be difficult, and we need to have a space that is safe for people to say what they think and analyze arguments and counter arguments. And so hear each other and support each other. And then go forth and write and act and change the world as a result. And I'll leave it at that.
Thank you so much. Yes. That was wonderful. We really appreciate those very eloquent remarks. And just in general, Terry, your support of this whole endeavor has really meant a great deal to all of us. So thank you so much for that. And also I want to thank Dean Skomp, who has been also quite supportive of these efforts and is showing her support by not only being here, but also will be presenting a paper as part of the conference. I want to thank my fellow organizers of this event, Sarah Nimes, Steve Ralston, Dong Rung, and Mark Pressler, who have been wonderful co-conspirators and supporters. And I want to offer special thanks to Justina Beinek. Justina's going to be coming up here in a moment to offer her own remarks and a few additional words of thanks. But I really want to take a special opportunity, a significant moment of this of our time together, to offer her thanks, because she has been just this amazing driving force behind this conference in literally every way you can imagine, from organizing the program and corresponding with many of you, to organizing and coordinating the keynote speaker visits, to doing the catering orders. She's really taken on the bulk of the organizational tasks. And so I would like to, I think we first need to give her a round of applause. To thank her. And I know, so maybe this is the sort of swanny spin on things, as usual, but it's also Justina's birthday today. And so I would like for us to sing happy birthday to her.
Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday, Justina. Happy birthday.
So, okay. So anyway, I still feel like I want to say more things, but I'll try to cap it at that. So thanks to all of you for coming out, for supporting this conference, by being here today, by moderating a panel, if you're here to moderate. If you're giving a paper, thank you. We're thrilled that you were interested enough in our endeavor that you decided you would submit a proposal. Thank you for coming. Organizing a conference is extremely hard work, but let's be honest, so is attending a conference. It can be hard. It can be hard to stay focused. It can be hard to stay interested and awake the whole time that you're at the conference. If you're presenting, it's really easy to feel nervous about putting yourself out there in front of your colleagues. You know, what will they think? What will they think of me? What will they think of my field about what I'm trying to contribute? Will it make sense to someone? Will what I have to say make sense to someone who's not in my field? I certainly asked myself these questions as I was preparing my own talk. So as we start off today, I just want to encourage all of us to push back against any feelings that might be burbling up right now along the lines of, this is really hard work, this is a lot of time, I don't feel like this right now, I'm not sure if I'm up for this, and try to think of this conference as an opportunity. And I think what I have to say along these lines really goes nicely with the remarks that Terry just made. It's an opportunity for those of us participating to grow personally by presenting on our scholarship, and engaging constructively with a colleague's scholarship. It's an opportunity for us to get to know each other better, to really come into dialogue, not in a kind of superficial, hi, how are you way, but really come into a dialogue around a topic that touches on our scholarship and our lives in one way or another. We all have bodies. They constantly perplex and amuse and disgust and surprise us. We've had them since we were born, and yet we still have a lot to learn, I would argue, about them. As most of you know, the first part of our conference title, Why All the Fuss About the Body, is also the title of Carolyn Bynum's seminal critical inquiry article from 1995 called Why All the Fuss About the Body, A Medievalist's Perspective. And in that article, Bynum took stock of the growing number of books and articles with the body in the title and the steadily growing interest in the history of the body as a fundamental component of cultural studies. She noted that despite this enthusiasm, there were, and I'm just going to quote her, there were, quote, no clear structures, behaviors, events, objects, experiences, words, and moments to which the body actually referred. She continued, quote, sometimes body, my body, or embodiedness seems to refer to limit or placement, whether biological or social, to natural physical structures, environment, or locatedness, the place, or to role, gender, race, class, as constraint. Sometimes, on the other hand, it seems to refer precisely to lack of limits, to desire, potentiality, fertility, sexuality, or to person or identity as malleable representation or construct. That's the end of her quote. So in the rest of the piece, Bynum pushed back against so-called dualist and essentialist interpretations of the body as natural and female mainly, and recovered the wide-ranging ideas about matter, body, and person that existed in the Middle Ages and have persisted into the present day. In more recent work, Bynum has endeavored to move these conversations beyond the study of the body exclusively to the study of matter and materiality in medieval religious life, including the materiality of images and visual practices. But I think her observations about how the body and embodiedness can refer both to limits or lack of limits are still very useful, and we might even draw on them at the very least for the purposes of this conference. We might draw on them in our endeavors to place the body at the center of these efforts to understand how local and global knowledge systems interact, inform, and transform each other, how bodies become places for projecting desires and imagining what's possible, while they are simultaneously constrained by environment, social structures, roles, race, class, and gender, and more, much more. So I will now turn things over to Justina, who is going to make a few more remarks and offer some additional words of thanks.
Thank you for the happy birthday. I didn't expect that. And enjoy the skeleton cake. This is a special nod to the body conference as rendered by Julia. Thank you all for being here today and tomorrow, I hope. And thank you for being with us earlier this week and last week and during the entire Easter semester, in which we have been reflecting on this enigmatic thing with which we are intimately familiar, that is the body. The body, as Bynum would say, the stuff, physicality, the flesh dress, continuously, as Kelly said, surprises us. I like that you said amuses us. And it also escapes our understanding of what it actually is and how it's linked to our mind, thoughts, and emotions. Ever since I read Caroline Bynum's Why All the Fuss About the Body article as a beginning graduate student, and that was years ago, the body has been in some way on my radar. Images of the body, high culture, popular media, their presentations of the body in various texts, ways of talking about the body in academic and regular conversations, And I've also been sort of interested in the lived body, the material reality that we experience on a daily basis, which allows us to experience the world in a singular way. And last week, the Religious Studies Department had a guest lecturer, Donovan Schaefer, and I really like the point he made during his lecture. He said, if we had different bodies, I'm paraphrasing, for example, if we had animal bodies, we'd experience the world very differently, and we'd also respond to the world very differently. Caroline Bynum has written, and that was my response originally to someone who back in May of last year was very skeptical of this topic, and I wrote in my email, so let me quote from Caroline Bynum. She says, the body is the wrong topic. It is no topic, or perhaps it's all topics. She says, the body, quote, we are told is the wrong category. But if it is a wrong category, Bynum says, what then is everybody writing about? I hope that during this conference, we can all ponder these questions. What is the body, and what is it that we see cropping up in so many disciplines? Bynum herself shows best how the body is a discursive category present in all disciplines in the humanities and social sciences, at the very least. When she talks about the Middle Ages, she shows the intense debates on the body taking place at that time, and she counteracts the claim that there was sort of no body in the Middle Ages, there was nothing to talk about. She says that there was, in fact, in the Middle Ages, a, quote, cacophony of discourses, end quote, regarding the body. And I hope that our conference will also show this cacophony of discourses, maybe in a slightly more orderly and less cacophonous fashion. When I asked Caroline Bynum, she was the guest speaker invited to the medieval colloquium. She could not make it in the end. And for whatever it's worth, I want to say that she's extremely supportive of this conference. She also loves Jessica's images that perplex many of you, from what I hear. And so I asked her, you know, we were supposed to have lunch with her and talk about this article, while the fuss about the body. And I also asked her, we'd like to read something by you, or at least talk to you about what you think about the body discourse today. It, you know, the 20th anniversary. 21st, I guess, but you know, has your thinking about the body changed? And she suggested that we read an excerpt from her most recent book titled Christian Materiality, and particularly a section titled Beyond the Body. One point, and this is my final point, that I found very interesting in that Beyond the Body section is that she says that since Aristotle, to the late Middle Ages at least, the body meant, quote, a changeable thing, gem, tree, log, or a cadaver, as well as living human being. Continuing to quote Bynum, understood in medieval terms, to explore the body was to explore stars and statues, blood and resin, as well as pain, perception, and survival, end quote. So I think this is a very interesting idea, and it sort of shows us how much more binary our thinking about the body has become. To change gears now, I'd like to thank all the 29 presenters and many, many more moderators who've agreed to participate in this. And I'm also, we are all grateful to the 21 academic and administrative units who have generously supported this conference. And I promise this might be the last time I'll read through this long list. We thank the Dean of the College for your support, the Mellon Globalization Forum, University Lectures Committee, and the departments and programs of Art and Art History, Asian Studies, English, Film, French, German, History, Humanities, International Global Studies, Italian, Politics, Religious Studies, Russian, Spanish, Women's and Gender Studies, as well as Sewanee Union Theater, Sewanee Writers Conference, Tennessee Williams Center, and Green Space Art Collective. And all images, as you know, are courtesy of our colleague Jessica Wall, and the conference title, as you know, is courtesy of Caroline Bynum, who says hello to conference participants. So, all right, I think we can...
Should we start?
Scott and Dorothy will ask you to officiate in any way you see fit.
To the front, but we need a couple more chairs.
Do you guys want to just say?
Yeah, we want to sit somewhere where we can see the slides.
Yeah.
That would be good. Well, thank you all for coming, and thank you, Justina, for inviting me to participate. I'm happy to help to moderate this panel, the first one on disciplining the body. I'm also very thankful that I wasn't asked to present, because this is really sort of outside my field. But at this very busy time of year, I'm very thankful also to the four panelists who were able to pull together papers for today's conference. So I think that we'll just go in the order that's on the menu here. So Kelly Whitmer from History will speak first. Her topic is youthful bodies and sentimental culture in early modern Central Europe. And I'll read through all of the paper presenters first. Then Sarah Nimes from IGS in Arabic, who will speak on incorporation in the Sufi milieu, apprenticeship and ritual in trade associations of early modern Egypt. And then Emmanuel Estedio Aqua from IGS, who will speak on We Needed Educated and Honest Youth, Youthful Bodies, Discipline, and Resistance in Post-Independence Ghana. And finally, Michael Wairungu from IGS in Swahili, Uniformity versus Swag, Styling the Body as Protest Among High School Students in Kenya. Now, I believe each of the speakers has 15 minutes. Do you need me to notify you?
Probably would be good just to wave. I might go over by a minute or two, and if so, I apologize.
Okay, thanks.
Okay, hi everyone. Hi again. So the goal of my presentation today is to offer you a glimpse into a research project that I'm pursuing, a new project that I'm pursuing, and it's really in a state of flux right now, about embodied knowledge and innovation culture in the early modern world. Topics of much discussion and interest among historians of science and technology today. The reasons for this are complicated, and this is not really my focus now, but as you might suspect, they're connected in powerful ways to a heightened preoccupation with the potential of techno-scientific innovations to solve pressing problems, such as global warming, just to name one. Problems that affect us all locally and globally, but are often easier to measure and to study than to actually solve. There's a pressing need to understand cultures of innovation and their histories, and I hope to illustrate when we take these histories seriously, they can actually help us challenge commonly held assumptions about particular moments in the past. They might also become part of efforts to challenge persistent assumptions about who possesses and historically has possessed expertise, what expertise is, and how it becomes embodied or inscribed on the body. Throughout the early modern period, and by that I mean the period from roughly 1500 to 1800, political power, knowledge, and expertise was believed to be closely associated with the age of one's body, with life stages, or what contemporaries refer to often as the ages of man. One finds many depictions of these ages. This is one of many, a Dutch engraving from the 16th century showing nine stages, each associated with a particular animal. And here's one produced 100 years later in Jan Comenius's Orbis Pictus with seven stages and depicting both men and women, just to give you a sense of the range of ways of representing this very ancient, actually, ages of man idea. Many contemporaries argued, and I think these images are basically advancing this argument, that as one moved through the life cycle, one climbed a social ladder, acquiring more knowledge the further one ascended, until one reached a middle point, middle age, and began to descend, losing power, moving away from the center to the periphery as one got older, especially among wealthier urban families in the Central European context I'm studying. Youth was increasingly described as a formative moment in the life cycle when young bodies were freed from the obligations and burdens that came with adulthood, including the possession of a special skill or obligation to produce or to carry out a specific task. Innovation, the ability to think creatively yet concretely about how to solve a pressing socio-political problem, was bound up with this particular way of thinking about expertise as something inscribed on the bodies of middle-aged adults, especially the bodies of middle-aged white men. In the early modern Central European, mainly German, context that I'm investigating, the idea that a young person could possess forms of expertise that could actually solve a real-world problem or generate improvement seems like it would have been fundamentally at odds with this way of thinking about the relationship between age and expertise. And yet, despite the resilience of this particular argument, and I'd suggest it's an argument or a way of thinking about age and the life cycle that is still very much with us, there were alternatives operating by the 18th century that are worth reflecting on. Alternatives closely connected to socioeconomic histories of artisanship and the emergence of specific body techniques associated with what Heidi Voskuhl has described as a sentimental culture. So first, I want to briefly address the issue of artisanship, the workshop as a space of innovation, and the challenges it presents to this kind of argument about age, power, and expertise. And then I'll move on briefly to the sentimental culture dimension of the broader argument about youthful bodies and their unique abilities to innovate that I'm endeavoring to construct. So in her book, The Body of the Artisan, historian of science Pamela Smith takes inspiration from medievalist Carolyn Bynum's observation that, quote, the deep interest in the body in Europe in the High Middle Ages sprang from a view that matter, and particularly the body, was pregnant with creative potential, end of quote. Smith's work explores how artisans throughout the period viewed it as their obligation to make matter's creative energies or powers visible and to use their work as a means of showcasing their abilities to manipulate these energies, or as Smith puts it, to, quote, play on nature's potential, end of quote. Smith has done groundbreaking work on the embodied knowledge practices of these craftsmen, who often passed information to each other intuitively, wordlessly, and instead communicated through a series of refined bodily movements and techniques. Young artisans learned their crafts by working alongside or apprenticing with a master craftsman in a workshop, often leaving their parents and families to live in a master's household as early as age 5 or 6. Some rapidly acquired proficiency in their respective craft practices, becoming expert practitioners by their early teens. However, in many instances, the ability to create or innovate that a young artisan may have possessed was actually increasingly disconnected from the hurdles he had to clear in order to reach adulthood. So despite clear evidence of expertise, in other words, a young artisan could not ascend the ladder until he'd entered into an extended period of travel, married, produced a masterpiece, and received the permission of his guild to set up a workshop. So in short, social conventions acted to decouple clear evidence of a young craftsman's expertise, even his virtuosity, from his actual possession of political power. Now, flash forward to 1700, where the particular way of thinking about the body of the artisan, or the power of the body as a creative force that I've been talking about, is being increasingly co-opted by philosophers, social reformers, and elites. So in effect, Smith and others have argued that modern scientific practices are the result of periods of sustained engagement with the craft practices and embodied epistemologies of artisans. The co-opting process intensified around the same time, around 1700, that a new social order or civil society began to emerge in many parts of Europe, a sentimental age marked by a growing preoccupation among individuals from a variety of backgrounds with the ability to create, to sense, to participate in the sentiments of other people, to feel empathy. And as Heidi Vossiel has explained, to, quote, experience feeling as a condition for humans to be prepared for meaningful and moral action, end of quote. Music making was an ideal practice wherein one might cultivate sentiments or feelings of empathy that could enable one to create innovations that could actually improve people's lives. Vossiel explores the ways in which the highly specialized forms of craft knowledge that went into producing automata, androids, early androids or robots in this period, were harnessed to this bigger agenda of teaching people how to feel, especially how to experience empathy and to act on those feelings. So here's an example of one of the automata from the 18th century that she analyzes. I thought it would just be fun to play. You got it? Okay. It's very short. Automaton making music, such as this one, presented viewers with a familiar cultural scenario from the period. Music playing women moved their bodies to stir feelings of the observing listener in a way that was intended to empower them to contribute to a collective project of defining the perimeters of a better civil society. Young men and women were assigned a variety of new roles in this culture, this admittedly idealistic culture of sediment. Indeed, several social reformers, often educators, drew attention to the peculiar potential of young people to develop creative solutions to pressing problems at a moment when some scholars have argued that young people were being increasingly excluded from an emerging public sphere, confined to the safety of their homes, the countryside, which was increasingly described as a healthier or safer place for young people to be than in urban environments, or to the new factory-esque atmosphere of schools, workhouses, and orphanages. The degree to which young people were increasingly redefined as able and even well-poised to participate as experts in this new sentimental culture is, I think, best observed in the educational reform projects or plans from the period and the high levels of interest in child prodigies, their bodies, and proficiencies. In the educational reform plans of the political economist Paul Jakob Mauerperger, for example, we find a visual pedagogical program described in this text, and I won't go into a lot of detail about this, but I wanted to name some examples. The program was designed to help young men make better use of expertise, the expertise that they came to possess, through routinized visits to collections. The program describes a series of bodily motions, including observational techniques, for discerning the utility of objects in early museums. according to this particular reformer. The problem was, like we saw with the young artisan example earlier, elite young men who were able to leave their familiar environments and travel returned home changed by their encounters with new peoples and places, but had few arenas within which they might actually apply their expertise systematically. Marperger's plans included harnessing the expertise inscribed upon young men's bodies by including them as members of state-sponsored scientific academies and advisory councils, where they would literally advise state leaders on the creation of new forms of techno-scientific innovation and public policy. It's clear that in the German context, some effort was made to implement these plans, admittedly radical reform ideas and plans, including the part about inviting especially gifted youths to actually join learned societies and scientific academies. And in closing, I'll just briefly mention the case of Jean-Philippe Baratier, whose image I had up at the beginning, which I think offers us an interesting example of this. He was renowned, famous as a child prodigy, invited to join the Berlin Academy of Sciences at age 14, after having already achieved recognition for his many achievements. And in the context of this academy, he operated at the center of several ongoing conversations about how to solve real and pressing navigational problems, like measuring longitude. The longitude problem was a big deal in this period. And how to develop better, more precise and reliable measuring instruments, just to name one example that I've recovered him writing about in some work I've been doing on his correspondence. So indeed, contrary to the rigid, universalizing, and even prescriptive way of thinking about age and the life cycle that we saw represented here, Baratier's example offered proof to people. It seemed to offer proof that an alternative was possible. His case seemed to prove that young people were not only capable of possessing expertise or unusual insight into the devising of solutions to pressing problems or questions, but that they too were capable of applying that expertise to the construction of innovations. Their examples, and Baratier was certainly not alone in this, affirmed for many the possibilities of embodied knowledge, of cultivating an ability to appreciate the feelings, concerns, even anxieties of other bodies in the interest of creating a different kind of society.
I was derelict earlier, not to mention that Ritri is going to provide some questions along with myself for the panelists, but we'll leave plenty of time for the audience to ask questions as well. Sarah is next.
Okay.
Thanks.
Thank you, everyone, for coming. I wanted to thank the Mellon Fund for supporting this research and some of the other related projects that I've had the luxury of working on since I came here in 2014. I'm particularly grateful to Justyna Bajnek, she's not in the room right now, for all of her work in organizing this event, but also for giving me so many opportunities to think through how my work intersects with recent work on the body. She actually gave me a stack of books of theory to read after she attended my last presentation. I hope that won't happen this time. So what I'll consider today are disciplinary regimes in a particular context, which is late 18th century Egypt. This period in Egypt is remarkable for many reasons, one of which was the ascendancy of the Sufi brotherhoods as a political and economic force in Egyptian society. The Sufi brotherhoods, and they're known as Turuk Sufiya, were formal initiatory organizations that were organized under the authority of a sheikh, which literally means an elder person, who was believed to possess an exceptional ability to model and enforce right belief and practice. The brotherhoods were also imagined as being individual and unique ways, and that's another literal meaning of the word Turuk, ways of being pious, or as the Sufis would say, a turuk lilleh, the ways of approaching God. So as ways to God, these organizations could be distinguished by their particular modes of body discipline. And the quintessential form of body discipline among these groups were rituals of remembrance, or zikr is the word in Arabic. And these rituals involved purification through intentional and scripted procedures for washing the body, known as wudu, particular positions for contemplative sitting, standing or lying down, particular gestures of the hands and eyes, and sometimes prescriptions for breath or for silence, usually combined with either the verbal or internal pronunciation or repetition of different combinations of phrases, with a special preference for the name of God or prayers for the well-being of Muhammad and his family and companions. The process by which these meditative rituals are learned is called talqin al-dhikr, which literally means inculcation of rituals of remembrance. So this is understood to proceed through companionship, sohbah, of a master who's perfected these practices and through the intentional emulation of his example. What I found so interesting in these studies is the way that some of these Sufi masters conceptualize the mechanism by which disciplinary practices function on the body, these epistemologies of embodied knowledge, and the kinds of results that they imagine these processes to produce, especially the relationship of these processes to power and authority. What I found, and it's not just me, this is a growing field in Islamic studies, is that these antique Muslim philosophers have very interesting things to say to our faith in the ability of reason to unveil error that's at the heart of contemporary liberal discourse about freedom and ethical thinking. At times, their views of the processes of inculcation, of the minute gestures and habits associated with power, and the relationship of these processes to the location of individuals and social hierarchies are every bit as sophisticated as contemporary analysis of the microphysics of modern disciplinary power in the work of Foucault and the many others who have built on his theories. In Sufi literature about pedagogy, there are countless aphorisms and stories that seek to illustrate the perils of excessive faith in our rational facilities. Human logic, memory, ethical reasoning, and analysis, while viewed in the Sufi tradition as necessary tools for engagement with the world, are also viewed as limited by the particularities of perspective. For example, the need for scholars in particular to constantly remind themselves of the limitations of their own rational faculties is enshrined in the ritual conclusion of legal rulings with Wallahu A'lam, which means, but only God knows. A popular hadith also links the inadequacy of knowledge to the necessity of practice. It can be translated as something like abstract knowledge, which is ilm, calls out to practice, which is amal, but if the latter does not respond, knowledge will go away. This hadith appears in a 12th century Sufi manual that enjoyed great popularity in 18th century Egypt. The author explains that the bodies of the Sufi masters contain akhlaq, which means character, but also dispositions and behaviors that speak to that character. And these akhlaq are no less a part of God's revelation, no less than a part of God's revelation. He says, and I quote, "The characters or the akhlaq of the masters have been polished through their perfection in modeling themselves after the messenger of God, peace and blessings upon him. They are the most successful of people in revivifying his sunnah, in all that he commanded and commissioned, censured and enjoined." So this is the view, this view is the basis for the pedagogical emphasis on inculcation or talqin, inscribing righteousness on the body through companionship of a master. So in my research, I try to think about the work that these conceptions of bodily discipline do in the production of social relationships among historical individuals, as well as in the invention and reproduction of political and economic systems and institutions. Today I'll focus on the economic dimension, and in Islamic jargon it's al-mu'allamat, the economic dimension of these relationships by a consideration of trade associations in Egypt in the 18th century. This is a new area of research for me within this broader project that I've described, so my conclusions today will be somewhat tentative. The trade associations, or the tawa'if al-mahniya, were associations of workers in a common trade under the head of a sheikh. The term is commonly translated as guilds by analogy to the European versions of these associations. And Western historians like Massignon have been intensely interested in the relationship of these organizations to their counterparts in the West. There's always the who came first argument that becomes very polemical. Their interaction with local military elites and other segments of society, as well as with imperial centers. And their adaptation in response to global and local economic, social, and political change. So what's of interest to me is not so much this large-scale socio-political perspective, but the way that these organizations are produced through disciplinary regimes of the body. I'll argue that these two kinds of organizations, the trade groups, the guilds, and the Sufi brotherhoods, operated according to a shared schemata of leadership shared schemata of leadership enshrined in common practices for discipline of the body. Its gestures, its dress, its functions, and its movement through space in relation to other people. I'll try to give you a sense of the resonance between the processes by which explicitly Islamic authority was cultivated through these Sufi pedagogies through an analysis of a speech that was written on the occasion of the retirement of the head of the Association of Producers of Bows and Arrows in the 1760s in Egypt and the ascension of his prized pupil to take his place. The speech was composed by one of the most prominent scholars of the period, Murtada Zabidi. And Zabidi was a Hanafi scholar of Indian origin who died in Cairo in 1790. He published prolifically in lexicography, in linguistics, in the field of hadith, which is the reports of the prophet's lives and sayings and deeds, in the field of genealogy, biography, and personal history, so a real Renaissance man, except not in the Renaissance. He was also an avid student of Sufi devotions and rituals, and published a collection of over 100 meditative practices, and again, those are called dhikr, that he had learned from prominent teachers across the Ottoman Empire. What interests me in this text that's given on this occasion of the celebration and graduation is its similar form, language, and I think function to the certificates that would be issued to students of Sufism upon their initiation into a brotherhood. And those certificates are called ahd or aqd, just meaning a contract or an agreement. In terms of structure, the text opens with prayers, quotations from the Quran, and hadith. And again, hadith are reports from Muhammad's life about the spiritual and ethical dimensions of the crafting of bows and arrows, their use in jihad, which is armed struggle in this context, and in defense of the Muslim community. The speech recalls Sufi pedagogies of companionship and discipline through an emphasis on the necessity of learning with a master when it states, quote, "Know my brothers in God and his messenger that every trade has a sheikh and a master. It's said that without a master, corruption will find it." The language use also reflects the intertextuality between descriptions of relationships in the guild and Sufi epistemologies and pedagogies. He writes, "The crafting of the bow and arrow has for generations been a noble profession, and the word that's used for noble is karim, which is an adjective that's also associated with the miraculous power of the saints. And the way among the forefathers," this is a quote again, "and their offspring is accepted and exalted." And here, the word for way is tariqa, which again is another word for the Sufi brotherhood. So there's a lot of resonance between the languages, the spiritual language, and then the practical language for talking about everyday relationships. The introduction continues. "It is as old as jihad and conquest of the obstinate unbelievers. So the crafting and use of the bow is linked to revelation through reference to the Quran and to the Sunnah with the statement, 'God commanded his prophet to ready himself to use force,' and explain that by this he meant the slinging of arrows." And then this is followed by a series of citations of Quran and Hadith. Remarkably, the crafting and use of a bow and arrow, those skills are represented in the text as a form of revelation in and of themselves. And this is another quote. "Adam was the first to carry a bow. The angel Jibril came down from heaven with a bow in his hand and a string and two arrows, and he gave it to him and taught him how to use it. And the same happened to Ibrahim and to his son Ismail." The image of the angel bringing the bow and the knowledge of its use is a clear parallel to accounts of the process by which the Quran was revealed to Muhammad. By extension, the rising master bowmaker comes to be imagined as a carrier of this divinely granted tradition. And this is affirmed in the subsequent section of the text, which places him in a line of masters and teachers, each of which has modeled himself after his teacher. So this line of teachers and students is expressed through another formal aspect that this text shares with the Sufi Ahd. And again, the Ahd is the certificate of initiation into the brotherhood organization. Sufi certificates of initiation, without exception, include a detailed record of the line of transmission of permission to teach that particular Sufi way of ethical living as it's been passed down from master to student through the generations. And this line of transmission is called a sanad. So the text declares, "When I saw his mastery of his craft, which followed his best knowledge and understanding of the foundations of the craft, I issued this ijazah to him," which means I issued this permission to him, "to be witnessed openly by all of the brothers," and the word is ikhwan, "in this noble trade. Just as I was given an ijazah by the righteous sheikh, the master in perfection and skill, the deceased Abdullah Effendi ibn Muhammad al-Busnawi, by virtue of the right he was given in that by his sheikh, the deceased Ali al-Albani, from his sheikh, Muhammad al-Istanbuli, along with his chain of authority, which reaches back to Abdurrahman al-Farazi, the Imam al-Tabari, by the rights that they took from the most famous imams of this art, Tahir al-Balkhi, Ishaq Rafa'a, and Abi Hashim al-Bawadi, with their isnad that come from sheikh to sheikh until they end. That is, until our master Ismail, God bless him and give him peace. So Ismail here refers to the son of Abraham, who's also imagined as the father of the Arabs in the Islamic tradition. This sanad includes masters from Bosnia, Albania, Turkish and Arab archers, as well as those from Iran and Central Asia and the Northern Arabs, and claims its origin with the prophet Ismail and by extension the angel Gabriel, linking the ascending student to what's imagined as a universal tradition of the craft that transcends and collapses the geographical and chronological space between these esteemed masters through the link of a shared bodily experience produced through the intimacy of apprenticeship. Finally, the text includes the requisite advice from the sheikh to his student, and I quote, "I advise him just as I would any of my brothers and myself that he dedicate himself to the cultivation of beautiful manners, to humble himself and carry himself in accordance with the most noble characters." So there are a couple of terms in this advice that deserve attention. The first is the term akhlaq, which I, as before, I translated as characters. Akhlaq refers, again, to a kind of integrated view of character imagined as behaviors that both reflect and produce an individual's beliefs and ethics. The concept of akhlaq includes behaviors that are not codified or abstracted but are subtle and require careful attention to be noticed. Put together, they produce in those who witness them an experience of charisma. And the Arabic word is baraka, but it has very similar etymology to charisma in the sense of blessing. And to people who observe it, it seems miraculous. In this sense, akhlaq is the texture of personality, behaviors, and comportment. And all of these are understood to express his, and less commonly her, spiritual station and righteousness. Even details such as what and how the person ate or slept are at times brought as evidence of their righteousness. A second concept that's important in this quote is the expression of self. In the advice to the student, in the advice that the student carry himself in a certain way and that he submit himself to the teachings of his master, the term nafs refers, as self, refers to the body of the person and at the same time to his identity. So this advice is for the student to submit his body to emulation, and again the word is talqin for the inculcation of the behaviors of the master. But to submit his body to those habits of the teacher, and the habits are imagined as having their origin in that initial revelation from Jibril to Ismail. After this, he goes on to advise the student to follow a series of points of professional ethics, including that he not sell weapons of jihad to non-believers, that he take it as his responsibility to know the religion of those who are buying, that he not sell weapons to children without their parents' written consent, that we need those laws in Tennessee. That buyers of arms must document an oath that they won't shoot anyone who's Muslim or any ally of the Muslims, that they won't shoot any dog or anything else that has a spirit unless they're hunting for food or otherwise forced to do so. But from this document, this document also suggests that the process of apprenticeship in these organizations established moral conduct in business relationships, not as an abstract code of rules or limitations, although it is articulated that way to some degree, but as the performance of this akhlaq of the masters. Again, good ethics as embodied in agreeable behavior, but also the mastery of their craft. And these akhlaq are embodied, are understood to be embodied traces or the legacy of an original divine revelation to the earliest humans to craft and carry the bow. From the studies of these trade associations, it's well established that they played a pivotal role in advocating for their fellow tradespeople, by managing product quality, by setting and enforcing standards of craftsmanship, which is also witnessed in this text, by managing the production of quantities and distribution, and even in some cases distributing earnings among members, which is a system known as ruqiyya. Despite the ubiquitousness of references to this form of social organization, there's an enormous disagreement among historians about how they're best defined and characterized. I think part of the problem is that the term used for the trade associations, which is ta'ifa, can refer to more formal organizations like the Sufi brotherhoods, but is also used to refer to religious sects or to ethnic groups that might not refer to them, might not even see themselves necessarily as a coherent group. Sometimes a ta'ifa is subdivided, such as in the case of a Christian ta'ifa, which existed within the ta'ifa of the goldsmiths, for example. So it would seem that the flexibility of this term expresses a social reality in which individuals had multiple overlapping affiliations. The biography of the student taking over the Bowmakers Guild is a good example of these overlapping affiliations. Ali ibn Abdallah, as he was named, was bought as a slave outside Egypt in the Balkans, or perhaps in Anatolia. So he's technically a Mamluk, which literally means slave, but was also the military caste in Egypt at this time. He was brought up in the women's quarters of a relatively wealthy household, where besides the mastery of the art of bow making, he also reportedly acquired basic literacy through study of the Quran and some Islamic law, which also makes him an alim, or a teacher, scholar of the law. So these are all social divisions that typically are projected on, or are Egyptian society during this period is understood as being divided into. His education also included what's referred to as a forosiya, which is a general term for the martial arts of the Mamluk warriors in this period. And treatises on the art of warfare also suggest the integration of what was imagined as a divinely granted code of ethics and skills for warriors, but that's outside of the scope of my presentation today. Ali was eventually freed, and the roles that he filled as an adult included the role of Hazandar, which was the treasurer or superintendent of the household he was living in, as well as a military post. And besides this, he was also a devotee of the Sheikh Sayyid al-Maqdisi, so he was integrated into the Sufi milieu also as a companion of this prominent Sheikh. So this points to the multiple associations that were typical of individuals in this period. So what I'm trying to argue is that different modes of incorporation functioned in this elite culture of overlapping identities. So the trade associations themselves were produced through two related processes. And the first and most significant from the perspective of this text is the incorporation of the craft and its ethics into the body of the aspiring bow maker through apprenticeship. And again, in their language, apprenticeship is suhba, or companionship. That is, incorporation starts with inculcation of the practical skills through which the particular group was distinguished, in this case, bow making, and the inscription onto the individual manners and behaviors that mark his body as part of that collective. Only second to this type of formal initiation into this type of initiation was the formal process of initiation into the organization as a brotherhood. So I think it's the secondary nature of the formal elements of the organization that leads to the difficulty that historians often encounter in describing them. The phenomenon of the ta'ifa confounds historians precisely because it's first and foremost a subtle process of the body and not a fixed institution. The problem is compounded by the fact that the traces of these processes are found precisely in the stuff that historians are most likely to toss out as waste matter of historical sources. That is, things like prayers and other discourse that are deemed as faith, which is imagined to be separate from practice, and in accounts of rituals and the experiences that they produce, which are also dismissed as the stuff of fiction and superstition. So what conclusions can be drawn from this mode of analysis that focuses on the way that the body is imagined, and why do they matter here in the 21st century? Ooh, I'm really not going to answer that question. I'm still in the process of thinking. I am in the process of thinking this through, thinking through how this part of my research fits into the broader theoretical questions that I've been trying to engage elsewhere. But I think that there's a concept of dignity that's useful in considering the way that the economics of Sarah, and this is from the talk that was here a couple weeks ago. What's his name again, the speaker that we invited? That's right. Aspect of dignity idea has sort of been knocking around in my head since that talk. But I think it could be useful for thinking about the economics of the ceremonial and sacralized character of archery in the way that it's imagined in the text of the speech. So to give some context to Ali's place in the broader Egyptian economy, in the decades leading up to Ali's life, firearms had become an increasingly common technology of warfare in the Middle East. And I think that this affect of dignity idea is a good way to think through the tension between the bearers of firearms and bowmen and the economic meaning of this embodied approach to reproduction of skilled labor and the goods that it produces. So long after the firearms were introduced, this elite units in the Mamluk military continued to prefer the composite recurve bow, which was a very tall bow that could be shot from horseback. And this is in part because it was a more effective weapon in some ways. In the hands of a skilled bowman, it traveled further than the firearms available at this time. It could fire rounds more quickly than the firearms, and it could be managed from horseback, whereas firearms had to be used by infantry. So the drawback of the bow from a rational economic perspective was that its handling was an art of practice and bodily discipline that required years to master, and that was only available through these kinds of initiatory organizations. Firearms were less effective, but could be handled by any able-bodied person, even one with limited experience with warfare. So there are accounts in the sources that predate Ali's life, again, the student who was graduating in this speech, that give detailed accounts of the heads of some military units who began buying firearms and paying wages to unskilled people to man them, and between them and their elite bowmen. The outrage of the bowmen is expressed in one account in terms of both the economic cost, because there was a sense that the shared wealth of the military unit was being squandered on an ineffective equipment and people, and in terms of a sense of personal dignity, that elite fighters could not be replaced with the uninitiated. So the difference between the bowmen and their gunpowder-bearing counterparts from the perspective of those who are complaining was one of exchangeability. The work of the bowmen in this confrontation, like the work of Ali the bowmaker slash soldier, is valued not merely for its efficiency, but for the quality of intention brought to the process itself. Labor of the body and its product, when experienced as a manifestation of the miraculous purifying power of these bodily disciplines, is here imagined as its own form of piety. From this perspective, again, a rational evaluation of performance in terms of inputs and outputs, that perspective misses a significant element, which is the non-material product of labor. Or as Zabidi sums it up in the closing lines of his address, piety is the foundation of everything. Piety is human capital.
I would like to thank the organizers for including me in this conference and to say thank you to all for coming. This paper comes out of a larger project on youth culture and popular politics in colonial and post-colonial Ghana. What I do today is to focus on the relationship between students and youth and Ghana's first post-colonial government. In a speech to open a branch and office of Ghana's ruling party, the Convention People's Party, at the University of Ghana, the premier university of the country, in 1964, the country's Minister of Defense reiterated the government's plan to use higher education to generate a cadre of disciplined, productive, and revolutionary young Ghanaians who would serve as important agents in the mobilization and development of the country along socialist lines. The minister, Kofi Bakon, who was then wearing his hat as a chair of the state-sponsored Committee on Education for Citizenship in Higher Educational Institutions, simply put the government's objective, and here I quote him, "We need the youth. We need even more the educated youth. But above all, we need the educated youth who is also dedicated. And the party and the government will do everything possible to assist our educational institutions to produce such youth." The speech reproduced extensively in the state press, and you have here an example. So the Ghanaian Times is one of the state-sponsored newspapers, and you have the speech being reproduced. The speech was the latest salvo in ongoing confrontations and debates between the government and the public universities, three of them at a time, over university autonomy, the purpose of higher education, and how all of these were related to nation building and development. The confrontations and debates coalesced around the idea of youth as model citizens. There was broad agreement in Ghana about the need for a well-educated and patriotic generation of post-colonial youth who would meet the country's development challenges. But there, agreement ended, as the meanings of these qualities and how to attain them through higher education intensely divided opinion. The government's statist and socialist interpretations of national development required disciplining students and youth. University students and youth worked within, but also challenged the government's attempted disciplinary regime. I argue that the government's effort to discipline youth and the opposition to it made for a contentious public culture in which youthful bodies were inscribed as a central mechanism of nation building, but it also helped to construct student and youth politics as a bulwark against governmental authoritarianism. My paper intervenes in two related bodies of historical literature on Ghana, and by extension, my intervention speaks to a larger historiography of sub-Saharan Africa of the 1960s, the decade of African independence from colonial rule. The first body of literature, a general one, overemphasizes the designs and agency of the leaders and government in the major political development of the time. In this historiography, Ghana's first post-colonial leader, Kwame Nkrumah, depicted there on Time magazine in 1951, and his CPP government are given primacy as historical actors. There is little attention to how subaltern actors shaped the exercise of power. And in that historiography, you find primacy being given to people like Kwame Nkrumah, to Gamal Nasser of Egypt, also in the picture with Nkrumah, Julius Nyerere of Tanzania, Felix Ofebuanyi of Ivory Coast, and so on and so forth. Related to the general literature is a specific one on the role of students and youth in the national politics of the 1960s. This literature ascribes minimal significance to the long-term political impact of Ghanaian student activism of the 1960s. Some of the works in the historiography carry a sense of disappointment that Ghanaian students, and indeed African students, seemingly did not display the same levels of radicalism that was found among students of the West in the global youth and student protest of the 1960s. In a typical article, one such historian, David Finlay, observed that Ghanaian students were mere, to quote him, spectators and secondary players in the politics of the Nkrumah period. Finlay focused specifically on the conflict between the Nkrumah government and the public universities. Others have amplified the same position. These works hardly explore contemporary historical sources, including student writings and publications, which review a high level of political consciousness and activism, and also show students as key participants in national politics. In the rest of this paper, I'll talk about the attempted disciplinary regime of the Nkrumah government. I'll then discuss the students' response to the governmental discipline, and then conclude with the implications of the fractious government and student relations for the inscription of youth or youthful bodies in the national development discourse, as well as the formation of an active student movement whose impact on national politics would grow even beyond the 1960s. A quick disclaimer, there isn't in this paper a direct engagement with the theoretical insights generated from the studies of the body, but I'm hoping that my focus on young people in Ghana will justify my inclusion in this conference and will generate some further questions as well. In the pursuit of its objectives, Ghana's first post-colonial government elaborated a disciplinary regime that involved state-sponsored youth organizations, an ideological institute, as well as various efforts to bring the institutions of higher learning under governmental control and suffusing their curriculum or curricula with a state socialist ideology. The government's objectives had a full backing of the state media with all the propaganda that went with it. The two most important state-sponsored organizations were the Ghana Builders Brigade for young men and women between the ages of 15 and 30. And the definition of youth here is more cultural and social than biological. Somebody could be as old as 35, but where he stood in relation to power or to material resources was what determined whether you were youth or not. Both institutions were inspired, the Ghana Builders Brigade and the Ghana Young Pioneers Movement, were inspired by models of youth organizing in the Soviet Union, East Germany, and the Kibbutzim of Israel. So for the Russian scholars, you probably recognize that the Young Pioneers Movement is an idea from the Soviet Union. The Builders Brigade, also known as the Workers Brigade, was established in 1957, the year of Ghana's independence, and represented the CPP government's early engagement with issues of youth. Members of the brigade were given civic and vocational training in various fields with the aim of disciplining and turning them into productive citizens. Brigade members worked on projects in Agric, road and housing construction, as auto mechanics, and also in dressmaking, among other crafts. I have here a picture of members of the other state-sponsored organization, the Ghana Young Pioneers Movement. And membership started from the age of 6 to about the early 20s. The Young Pioneers, the government had more revolutionary aims for the Young Pioneers. And so they were exposed to a broader range of activities and skills training, including technical expertise in seamanship, airmanship, engineering, as well as in more traditional fields, such as dressmaking, textile design, and agriculture. The Young Pioneers received ideological training at an Institute of Economics and Political Science, basically an ideological institute, set up in 1961 to train young cadres who would promote socialism in the country. Branches of the Young Pioneers Movement were established in secondary and post-secondary institutions. The movement reflected the ruling party's progressive identification of ideological training with general education, an intensification of the struggles over youth, and the formation of a public sphere in which issues about youth would become very important because they were at the center of the development of the post-colonial nation. Higher education would become the terrain where these issues and struggles would be made more manifest. The ruling party expected a more nationalist and pan-Africanist fervor to be in play at the universities and vowed to impose that by reforms, especially given the widespread suspicion in government circles that the universities had become hubs for anti-government criticism, unpatriotic activities, and pro-West liberal ideas. When the president, Kwame Nkrumah, became the chancellor of Ghana's university in 1961, the state-owned newspaper, the Ghanaian Times, hailed the moment as an end to the days of the universities, to quote the paper, as dens of academic reaction, end of quote. The paper decried the content of the university's existing curricula, and also, as a result of the president's ascension to the chancellorship, anticipated changes in the curricula that would, to quote the paper again, produce young African men and women who are prepared to use their hands and their brains to accelerate Ghana's reconstruction along socialist lines and Africa's redemption along Nkrumah's path. And Ghana, in these early years of independence, was pretty much interested in foreign policy as well. Kwame Nkrumah believed that Ghana should punch above its small weight. And so he was very much all about not just the country, but the continent, and by extension, international politics generally. The government's attempts to bring the universities to heel involved the deportation of some Western expatriate professors for allegedly encouraging reactionary thought on campus and for alleged seditious activities. This was followed with the pressures on the universities to organize compulsory civic education classes for students. A government-sponsored demonstration against the arrogance and anti-state attitudes of university students, and here I'm quoting from one of the newspapers, forced the issue on the university. The university authorities successfully refused to have the civic courses as part of the curricula, but settled for a series of lectures under the title of Education for Citizenship to be given by party activists as extracurricular activity, and therefore our student participation was voluntary. The government followed up the civic education strategy with the arrest of 6 national student leaders for inciting criticisms of government actions. I have here images of state newspapers, so perhaps difficult to see, but the bold headline says, "Down with academic arrogance." And this follows a demonstration organized by the ruling party on the campus of the University of Ghana, in which thugs of the party basically moved to dormitories, smashed windows, beat up students as a way of intimidating them. You have here another piece also from 1964 in which there is an editorial on academic freedom. And the paper makes the argument basically, quoting government officials, that government does not believe in unlimited academic freedom. That the notion of it, they argued, is too Western for the Ghanaian situation. They insisted on the party and government having a hand in the content of education. I have here another one in which there is insistence on varsity boys, that is boys from the university, needing to serve the people. And so the notion that They were going to receive a liberal education and go on into private lives was to be abandoned. The arrest of the student leaders and ongoing intimidation and threats against the university community would force the students into open confrontations with the government. While the students agreed with government that educated youth should be central agents in the country's development, they argued, that is the students, that the government's attempt to restrict university autonomy and curtail democratic freedoms would not produce the desired results. Under the leadership of the National Union of Ghana Students, a budding student movement emerged which focused on government action and policies, whether they were peculiar to the universities or of general national interest. When Ghana became a one-party state by mid-1964, the Students' Union served as the informal national opposition to the ruling party. The government's response to student criticisms clearly indicated the influence and impact of the students. The student movement expresses activism through conferences, demonstrations, class boycotts, protests, and public campaigns. These were buttressed with student periodical publications which were circulated within and outside of the universities. And here I have two examples, or an example of a student magazine that was meant to encourage students in their opposition to the government. You have the very first issue with a picture of the president. So what they would do is basically flatter the president, borrow the language of the ruling party, talk about the socialist revolution, and so on and so forth. But they believe that that should be on their own terms and not the way the government was seeing it. And you have there another issue, this time with a picture of a younger Ahmed Bembella of Algeria, who was an ambiguous icon in Ghanaian public culture. On one hand, he was seen as a friend of Kwame Nkrumah, a revolutionary friend, and so the government loved to display his images, but the students here are also appropriating the same person and are arguing something different. A less well-prepared bulletin by the students. This is from one of the halls of residence of the University of Ghana, in which they declare that they shall continue to be outspoken on matters which concern our universities and on any issues relevant to the momentous African revolution. So they tended to borrow the language of government, mimicking it, but had their own interpretations of it. On February 24th, 1966, when the government of Kwame Nkrumah was removed from power in a coup d'etat, Ghanaian university students were among those who jubilated at the moment. And here I have a slide of a statue of the then president having been pulled down following the coup on February 24th, and kids who potentially could have been members of the Young Pioneers Movement playing around at the fallen statue. And there is a picture of the university students. This is interesting for a number of reasons. One, the sign that says Chinese go home is actually a repudiation of the socialist foreign policy of the government. While Ghana was officially a non-aligned country, it had indicated throughout the 60s that it preferred relations with the Soviet Union and the Chinese. So upon the overthrow of the president, the students were saying that the Chinese, who tended to dominate in diplomatic circles in Accra, should head back home. What is also interesting is that earlier in the 60s, they had demonstrated against the wearing of the gowns, which was required of university students. But on this day of the coup d'etat, they chose to put on the garb of a disciplinary regime they had kicked against in opposition to that of Kwame Nkrumah. The students' jubilation was not unexpected, given the antagonistic relationship that had come to exist between Nkrumah's government and the Baden student movement. Contrary to the existing scholarship, student activism in this period constituted a critical part of national politics. The confrontations of the early 1960s laid the foundations for the political engagement of Ghanaian students in national affairs in the late 1960s and 70s. The student movement would construct itself as a force against the abuses of government and a defender of national interest, a role it successfully performed in the late 1970s, for instance, when it successfully led public opposition to two military regimes which forced the regimes out of power. The debates and confrontations between the government and university students also reified Ghanaian youth as central agents in nation building, an idea that continued to inform and shape national discussions about development and the purpose of education in Ghana today. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Yusina, and your colleagues for organizing this conference. I want to echo a disclaimer that Emmanuel put, that my work may not exactly fit into the theoretical framework suggested, but I will take the challenge that the dean posed that we be part of the conversation. So I'm willing to take new ways of looking at the same material. I'm looking at uniformity versus swag, styling the body as protest among high school students in Kenya. The work that I'm about to present is drawn from a doctoral research that I did in Kenya on a phenomenon that we call shame. I'll define it. Its origins is Nairobi, the capital of Kenya, but I decided to go outside Nairobi to see what happens to the phenomenon. And I picked two major towns which are connected in terms of transport network to Nairobi. One is Nakuru and the other Mombasa. At some point, I will refer to this photo because I'm looking at how students modify the school uniform and use the body as a performance, and that I will be looking at how these bodily performances fit into the phenomenon that I'm calling shame. Outside the school, I will also look at how students perform or use their bodies to negotiate identity. So I'll keep this image on because it's the main point of reference. Thank you. In Africa today, many urban youth have embraced popular culture as a pedagogical tool more than education and the nation state. In Kenya, for example, schools promote English and standard Swahili for official and examination purposes. They also prescribe, quote unquote, homogeneous mode of dressing and certain ways of presenting the body. However, many young Kenyans have turned away from these officially sanctioned linguistic and non-linguistic practices in favor of sheng. Sheng is a style of speaking associated with urban youth. While embracing sheng, these young Kenyans have also adopted certain body mannerisms that contravene the prescribed ways of carrying their bodies. This suggests a disconnect between the official school policy and sheng speakers' desired distinct social identities. Consequently, language use and presentation of the body become potential sites of struggle between school authorities and enthusiasts of sheng. In this presentation, I focus on the students' embrace of non-linguistic aspects of sheng in relation to the prescribed body hexes. According to Bourdieu, body hexes is a durable way of presenting one's whole self, that is, the body, with regard to ways of speaking, dressing, thinking, walking, and even standing. In order to capture the non-linguistic aspects of sheng, I conceptualize sheng using Arvine's notion of style, which is, and I quote, social semiosis of distinctiveness, end of quote. Arvine's notion of style refers to the various linguistic and non-linguistic ways that, and I quote, individuals navigate among available varieties and try to perform a coherent presentation of self, end of quote. For this performative representation of self to be realized, Arvine argues that there has to be a social framework of witnesses who pay attention and provide social evaluation. My presentation is based on an ethnographic research that I conducted in two high schools in Nakuru and Mombasa, the cities that I showed you, two major towns where use of sheng had not been explored before. The research found that many young people embrace sheng as a nonviolent tool of protest against the officially sanctioned quote-unquote homogeneous identities. In the remainder of this presentation, I examine the modifications that sheng enthusiasts do to the prescribed mode of dressing and body mannerisms, and the meanings that they attach to these modifications. In Kenya, as in many other parts of the world, schools are agents of the state for producing quote-unquote good and desirable citizens with regard to language, dressing, law and order, among other aspects of nationhood. For example, each of the two schools where I conducted my research had a set of rules which outlined the prescribed uniform and bodily behavior. Students were required to strictly abide by these rules for the entire period of study. The teachers that I interviewed reported that these rules helped in instilling quote-unquote discipline, enhancing quote-unquote decency, and quote-unquote equalizing the students. Additionally, these teachers said that the prescribed school uniform helped in monitoring the students within and outside the school and in distinguishing them from the neighboring schools, especially the bad ones. In the Nakuru, one of the key rules stated that, and I quote, students will behave in a proper and respectful manner at all times. They will not do anything which breaks the laws of Kenya, end of quote. This rule shows the connection between schools and the state in the production of desirable citizens. Specifically, both the state and schools seek to produce disciplined bodies by emphasizing respect for established authority. Ordinarily, one would expect that students would embrace the prescribed behaviors in order to earn acceptance from school authorities and other social rewards. On the contrary, I observed that students embraced alternative social identities for various reasons. For example, students in a focus group in Mombasa told me that they did not like wearing school uniform because it curtailed their desired freedom. One of them, that I will call Tinga, explained that those students understood that school uniform was meant to equalize them and to enhance decency. Students and teachers differed in their definition of decency. According to this student, Tinga, decency in youth perspective is tied to quote-unquote fashion, freedom, and having swag. Swag refers to that unique aspect of one's identity that distinguishes him or her from peers and is highly regarded in the Sheng-speaking networks. Sheng speakers' desire for swag enhances ingenuity, further prompting them to modify their school uniforms and other prescribed behaviors. In Nakuru, one female student, Ololo, reported that female students negotiated swag by wearing jewelry in school, head trimming and tightening their skirts to reveal body figures. This is Ololo on the screen. Ololo, as if trying to elaborate her point, requested that I take a picture of her posing in order to capture her swag. The various aspects of Ololo's swag challenged the prescribed decency among female students as well as the culturally ascribed notion of femininity. As you see on the screen, I have numbers. Each of these numbers point to a very subtle modification of the prescribed body behavior. Number one is a bracelet, which is not allowed in school. Number two is a civilian t-shirt. Number three is a sock, which is not of the prescribed size. Number four, as you see, is a tie, which has been loosened. Number five points to untucked blouse. And also, number six points at the size of the skirt. While the prescribed one should go below the knees, Ololo has trimmed in order to be above the knees. Male students, too, modified their school uniforms. In Mombasa, I observed that students like Tinga, that I mentioned earlier, performed his swag by wearing a school shirt with tightened sleeves to emphasize his biceps and visibly put in his pocket a pack of cut-out 200 Kenyan shilling notes secured with a rubber band. A real banknote on top masked the fake bills, but allowed him to project him as, and I quote, a rich and cash money guy. When I talked to Tinga, he told me that his swag was inspired by the music celebrities from the US called, quote unquote, Cash Money Brothers. In this particular performance, Tinga was able to project his desired masculinity and rich man's identity by exposing his biceps and bluffing respectively. According to Newell, bluffing is an artful performance of the illusion of financial success, and its power lies in the ability to convince peers to believe that it is true. In the case of Sheng, recall that a successful representation of self operates within a social framework of witnesses who pay attention and provide social evaluation. As alluded by students Tinga and Olulung, Cheng Speaker's notion of swag is greatly inspired by the fashion trends that they encountered in the marketplaces, as you see here. This image I was given by one of the students, and he told me that this is how they perform swag. Note that one student alone or one Cheng Speaker alone cannot claim to have swag. He has to claim in relation to others. Note the subtle similarities and differences. Yes, they are greatly inspired by the fashion trends that they encountered in the marketplaces and the global popular culture mediated by the mass media. The majority of my student informants reported that they were inspired by music celebrities from the US, especially African-American rappers like Lil Wayne. Even those informants who mentioned popular Kenyan local artists like Prezo or Octopizzo referred to those whose styles resembled those of African Americans. At a broader level, despite the fact that African American styles, such as in music, dance, and sports, are received with admiration that is also mixed with deprecation by the dominant white middle class in the US, youths in many countries outside the US find these styles attractive, partly because they resonate with a desire for freedom and distinctiveness. This desire for freedom and distinctiveness is mainly articulated through performance. According to Kochman, the notion of performance is central to the life of African Americans, whether it is walking or dressing. They all aim at demonstrating their quote-unquote swagger. Similarly, Cheng and other urban youth cultures like Nuchi in Abidjan are characteristically performative. For example, Newell, who did his research on Nuchi in Abidjan, argues that, and I quote, being Nuchi is a continual performance, down to the very presentation of the body. You can't just say something Nuchi and be Nuchi. You must act the act, end of quote. In the context of my research, some students embraced performative walking styles, which contravened the prescribed body hexes. In the Mombasa school, I asked students in a focus group, and they told me that they knew of a particular student in grade 11 who assumed a certain walking style whenever he was called by a teacher during school assembly. His performative walking style drew attention from other students and made them laugh. I argue that they laughed because they associated his walking style with rebelliousness. Cheng Speaker's embrace of swag generates covert prestige, which is the value implicitly attached to linguistic and cultural forms used to rebel against established authority. This covert prestige also comes from consumption of popular culture instead of the state-sanctioned social identities. Previous scholars of popular culture argue that it opens new spaces of cultural negotiation, social definition, and confrontation with the established social order. In this context, Cheng Speaker's embrace of these alternative identities put them in conflict with school authorities. For example, during the time of my research, several girls' high schools in different parts of the country protested that they should be allowed to wear shorter, tighter, and more appealing skirts as part of the school uniform rather than the prescribed long skirts, which they regarded as quote-unquote outdated and quote-unquote unfashionable. These sentiments caught the attention of the then Minister of Education, who in turn challenged parents and teachers to respond to students' desires. In one of the schools that he visited, the minister questioned the prescribed long skirts and reminded the school authorities that, and I quote, those female students were in school to become Kenyan citizens, not Catholic nuns, end of quote. While the minister's statement speaks to issues of nationalism and modernity as envisioned by the state, I argue that Cheng Speaker's stylization of school uniform and other aspects of behavior is a nonviolent protest through which they exercise their agency in defining themselves using preferred badges of identity. In the process, they also challenge the dominant homogeneous official ideology promoted in schools, which is the basis for the state-sanctioned Kenyanness of, and I quote, one people, one nation. In summary, This presentation has examined the various stylistic modifications that Shen speakers do to their school uniform and body mannerisms. I have argued that young Kenyans embrace Shen as a nonviolent tool of protest against the officially sanctioned homogeneous identities in schools, which are aimed at producing quote-unquote desirable citizens. I have also argued that young Kenyans' embrace of Shen is driven by their desire for swag, which is a highly regarded attribute among peers. Shen speakers' notions of swag entails being distinct and fashionable, and is modeled around African-American celebrities as projected in the mass media. Overall, the presentation has demonstrated the growing influence of popular culture mediated by the mass media over education system and the nation state among many young Kenyans in urban high schools. This influence of popular culture also applies to other urban youth cultures in urban Africa, like Nuchi in Abidjan. It is therefore important for governments in post-colonial Africa to rethink the state-sanctioned quote-unquote homogeneous identities because they are increasingly losing appeal among many young Kenyans. Thank you.
Disclaimers, caveats that Michael and Daniel gave that their papers didn't really fit in. I thought they fit in very well with the other two papers and in fact made the panel richer. So what we will do with the questions is I have a question for both of you, and then we'll have a question from Scott, and then after that we can take questions from all of you. So my question is in a panel which is about disciplining the body, and this is a question for both of you, I have specific questions as well, is how do the bodies resist to being disciplined? And I think Daniel and Michael in some ways addressed that question already, but I would be interested in knowing specifically, like from the text that you discussed, if that's something you can address. And a specific question for Kelly, I would like to know, so the body is expected to perform in a creative way, and you've mentioned in your abstract that there were all these triggers, and travel would be one of them. So if you can speak, and I know like in a talk it's not possible to address all of them, but I would just want to know if you can address that, how travel would help, like just as an example. And for Sarah, and because you mentioned that Hamidi is Indian, I feel like a sense of entitlement in pressing you to answer this, but is Hamidi's text unique in the time, in the way that it's, the relationship between the body sort of making this public performance and then bringing in economic organizations and spiritual form that together, but is this something that is seen only in Hamidi's work, or is it something that's sort of common to the period?
Should I answer that first? Because maybe it's a shorter one, I don't know.
Yes.
Sure. Yeah.
Yes. I think, no, Zabidi's work is pretty typical.
Oh,
and
sorry,
he's, it's okay, it's fine. So, and actually his name means from Yemen, but he's not from Yemen either. So, but no, it was a global community of scholars, and the work was very formulaic. And so it was this sort of elite culture that traveled a lot, and they studied with scholars from all over the place. So. And most of his education was at the Azhar University in Cairo. So his work was typical, and it drew on the books that were popular at the time in Egypt.
So the particular pedagogical manual by that political economist I mentioned, it's a very interesting, rich text where he gives lots of instructions to young travelers. And he talks about travel as this sort of mode that a young person enters into, where they're in a state of constant encounter, and they're having all these encounters with individuals. Either their sort of senses are heightened. They're also encountering in collection spaces what they visit. They're encountering objects, and that might sort of trigger new ideas. They might be able to make connections between things in the context specifically of a collection that they wouldn't think of in another context, and they needed to be disciplined to understand how to assimilate those things, how to assimilate that knowledge and then to apply it. And they also needed to be given a forum some kind of venue in which to apply it. So he was advocating for creating all these new institutions and for academies and things to take their ideas, however seemingly far-fetched, seriously.
Okay.
Did you guys want to? Was that just for the two of us?
Yes.
Or, okay.
And like how the body is resisting. Do you want to speak to that?
Yeah, I suppose I could speak to it. I mean, it's a very idealized literature of practice, and there's a focus on people who are seen as being the perfection. You know, there's a lot of talk about perfection, and the word is kamel, so somebody who's really got everything. But the place where you see resistance is when people's failings are reported. Because discipline is imagined as something that leads someone closer to God and leads to enlightenment and in this sort of idealized representations, but I mean, in one of the central characters whose biography I use, they talk about he hoarded stuff in his house, and when it was after he died, they discovered that there was this like stuff that was kind of squirreled at these extra food that was squirreled away, and this was a huge embarrassment. And the other thing he did is he gave an enormous piece of land to his wife, which was just a terrible thing. So he had this sort of sentimental failing where, rather than keeping the order together, he had sort of given into this more earthly kind of sentimentality, and that was the end of that brotherhood. They were stripped of all their posts eventually, and the governor said explicitly he gave everything to this young woman who was a manumitted slave. So I think it's in the negative discourse that you see the resistance of the body in that way, of either sentimentality or the desire for these kinds of creature comforts.
Thank you. Scott has questions for Michael and Manuel.
Great. First of all, I really enjoyed both Michael's and Manuel's papers. And I have two comments/questions for Manuel and one for Michael. First of all, Manuel, when you're going through the paper, and even beginning with the young pioneers, you refer to the Soviet influences. But it was very clear to me that young pioneers existed in China as well. And as you proceeded in the talk, I kept writing in my notes, what about China? The socialist education movement occurred in 1964 as a predecessor to the Cultural Revolution. And it sounds a little bit like the Cultural Revolution was taking place in Ghana during that time period. So I think highlighting some of the Chinese influences could be useful. And then secondly, and related to my understanding of how the young pioneers operate in China, is that it's an interesting way of trying to use these kinds of organizations as recruitment tools. So there's a voluntaristic element to the discipline that is being articulated. So it creates a kind of process by which people can commit to the regime's ideology through physical and ideological discipline, but it's a voluntary kind of orientation. So it's just another comment. Sorry, I'm not very good at questions today. For Michael, I very much enjoyed this paper too, and it struck me, I was trying to think through why the switch at the end, the kind of punchline that the Ministry of Education saying it's okay to engage in swag and don't try to make these people into nuns. I thought it was a very fascinating thing, but part of what fascinates me about the paper is the way in which you deal with swag in the context of others observing it. And it's only really subversive and distinct in relationship to others. And so while the claim of the Ministry of Education that it may be that the uniforms are losing their appeal, it's also perhaps an attempt to empty swag of its subversive quality, so that it's no longer going to be in opposition, because it's only when it's in opposition that it's dangerous to the regime. So I guess that's more, again, another comment rather than a question.
Maybe I respond.
Okay.
When I say the government should pay attention,
uh-huh,
I understand the beauty of SWAC, okay, is its inability to persist. However, teachers need to step back and, instead of fighting these behaviors, look for alternative ways where we can be comfortable with heterogeneity. We don't really have to be homogeneous all the way. We can be homogeneous and disciplined at the same time.
A quick comment. So definitely there was the Chinese influence in evolution of state-sponsored youth organizations in Ghana. In the initial effort to model the youth organizations over foreign ones, government delegations went to the three countries that so the Soviet Union, East Germany, and to Israel, and they got some technical assistance from these countries as well. But when Chinese diplomats became prominent in Accra, the national capital, they also helped shape the way the Young Pioneers Movement evolved. And the influence continues in many ways till today. And yes, there is a voluntary dimension to the situation then as well. There were youth associations that didn't belong to the government set up, but they mirrored the government's ideals. The only problem they had with the state-sponsored youth organizations was that at some point, these youth organizations engaged in what has come to be called the personality cult of Kwame Nkrumah. They sacralized his personality, will speak of him as if he's God, and so on and so forth. And some of these youth associations belonging to churches were opposed to that kind of sacralization of the president. But there was a voluntary dimension to it, yes. The students, in many ways, agreed with some of the things that the government wanted to do. And so in some senses, they appropriated what government was doing. But they wanted to do so on their own terms, not necessarily being corralled into the statism that the government was preaching at the time.
In your research and talking to the students, how pervasive did you find Sheng and this desire for swag among the overall student population? Was it a large proportion of it, or were there students you sort of recognize, as Dr. Willis was saying, as a kind of peer constraint that they had to have swagger if they wanted to fit in and then rejected that on their own?
Please tell me your name so that
Toby.
Toby. Thank you so much. Well, I want to admit, yes, Sheng was pervasive. However, I have to acknowledge that they operate in very fluid ways. Some students would associate with swag or Sheng in this context, but they would be able to switch when they see teachers. So it's a performance. Yeah.
One that's specifically about creating what the body in connection to the land should be for this new Ghanaian citizenship, and then the other one being creating what the mind and the connection to the broader intellectual world, that where you were talking about this idea of engaging with Africa at large and with higher education and pushing back against expat professors. And I was wondering if you could speak a little bit to the dichotomy of these two different ways of creating citizens that Nkrumah and his government were trying to get at, but that focused, in my understanding of it, if they're taking their example from Israel and others at that time, that is a very specific example, that is a sort of one's this idea of act and get your hands in the soil and grow your own food and the mind will follow, and the other one of the mind and the body may or may not follow.
I think that both approaches were present in the government's plan. So, and hence the reason why higher education became such a terrain for conflict. Because on one hand, the government was interested in a cadre of students who were as intellectual as any you'd find under the sun, given to serious study, dedication to the sciences, to the humanities and social sciences. But the thinking was that they didn't want these students to be divorced from the land. They should also be agrarian or have some interest in agriculture at the same time. So I didn't read all of the newspapers, but you find in the newspapers, the state newspapers, this sort of discourse in which there's a combination of a pro-intellectual approach, but also we don't want university students who say that, well, I've left my grandfather or grandmother in a rural area and I'm not going back. You come to Accra to study, but you should find dignity in labor, in hard work. You should be able to till the land. I haven't explored fully the sort of intellectual influence that Israel had, but I definitely do know that there was a connection. Mm-hmm. In fact, some of the foreign officers who came in to help with the state-sponsored programs came in directly from Israel. This is also at the time that Israel was using Ghana to, well, actually Ghana was requiring Israel to provide weapons for liberation movement around Africa.
Right.
And so Ghana was sort of a stopover for the input coming in from Israel. The situation would change when Ghana decided to go with Pan-Arabism as opposed to,
Michael, I was curious about the gender differences in SWAG,
yes.
Right? Because the picture you showed us, until you started talking through, I found myself wondering if that was an example of a female uniform or a male uniform. And assuming that the state itself, if these are uniforms to create citizens, I was going with the assumption that the state has very distinct ideas of what it wants its female and its male to look like. So, okay, Kelly, this is going to be a weird one, perhaps a little. But I noticed that in that picture that you showed at the end of Jean-Baptiste, where you talked about how him as showing that you could have expertise younger, mm-hmm. I noticed that he died really young.
He did.
And I was wondering if it was, I mean, this is maybe no way to get at it, but the first thing I thought of was, well, actually, he was invited into expertise at about that point in his life, mm-hmm. right, that he would have had he lived a longer life. And I was wondering what sort of discourse or ideas there might be around this idea of prodigy or somebody whose life is constricted as such. So he's really sort of one unique example mm-hmm. of somebody whose life was very compressed, or if it's,
right.
or how to understand it is broader. Sarah. well, I have 4,000 things I can say about you, but I will narrow it into asking you to talk a little bit. So I was curious how understood, so I thought you did this amazing job of showing these links between the language and between Turk and Akhlaq and all these things, between the Brotherhood and the trade associations. I wanted to understand, and that people were a part of multiple things. I wanted to understand the competition between, if that's the right word, if I were a member of a trade association and I were a member of a brotherhood, if I would understand them as being just different parts, or if certain trade associations were dominated by specific brotherhoods, and what would happen when that was challenged or pushed back against, or if somebody wanted to be a bow and arrow maker but was not a part of a brotherhood, or and so on. So there y'all go.
Thank you.
If I can just assert myself, I know that we're out of time.
Sorry.
So if you can all just very concisely respond, and then I think we're going to quit for this panel. Oh, it's okay. It's our fault.
There's a question.
Yes.
Let me respond to the gender dimension. While my photos showed like there was a very clear distinction between SWAG for women and SWAG for men, one, I have to provide the broader context that I did my research in predominantly Christian schools, where skirts were associated with men and pants were associated with boys. In that case, it would be possible, because of that line of distinction, to say modification of pants is a gender because pants are associated with men. However, somebody else who may do research in Islamic schools might come with a different conceptualization of swag in gender. Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. So it's a highly fluid and contextual aspect of identity.
Just quickly, I think the fact that he dies young does matter, and he's sort of valorized and, you know, held up as this example, the shining example of a young expert who, tragically died young, right? But at the same time, he dies when he's like 19 or 20, and he does get inducted into the Academy of Sciences at age 14, and he's like hanging out and corresponding with those members, and also corresponding with members of the British Royal Society around that too. So that's this. that same time. So that's a span of like 6-7 years where he gets to kind of be and perform his expertise before he dies tragically. So, but I think you're onto something important.
My sense as to the different affiliations and how they interacted is that they weren't competitive, they were just overlapping. So, I mean, for Zabidi, for example, he had over 100 teachers that he studied with, and he said, I took this religious order, basically. Like, it's almost as if he's initiated into all of those different organizations, but obviously he's not as committed to all of them equally, but it was possible to study with lots of different people and to have all of those different associations. It seems like they weren't not competitive.
I think that's it for it. Thank you all. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you.